Greetings in the name of the Most High. Out here watching the firmament at about 3:30 in the morning is really, I see these things in other dimensions flying around. Not that they have anything to do with me, but your eyes can kind of not blur, but there's a way to see them. I kind of do it automatically. I think most people tune it out, you know, refocus their eyes and, you know, tune it out. But there's a lot going on there. It's just that it's an impersonal reality, you know. Of course, unless you're on one of these abductee victim, professional victim, read that Stockholm Syndrome people that is in love with the abductors and the hybridization and all that. And there is that, but it's usually tied to the satanic ritual abuse, pedophilia. Oh, sounding not so alien after all. Yeah. If you listen to the... all right, little one, you stay there. If you listen to the... testimony of this, well, there were some that I talked about before. All right, little one. You're not going to be able to come and go like that when you want. So, you know, thank you for putting up with me in my yesterday's brief pod. It was during a road trip, and I was just feeling... the last 3 days, 4 days now, this, it couldn't have just been from fatigue because it was just this, like, I called it a beam at one point, and then eventually it was just terrible. It was definitely like some kind of witchcraft or something like that, because I'd felt that, that happened before once, that same way, and, well, they're out there. They throw stuff on you. They see us. Anything that has to do with Jesus, lifting up the Lord, salvation, anything like that makes you a target. You know that. And there's no sense acting like, you know, like it's not happening because, you know, but all I had was really prayer and... you know, it was just like I wasn't here. Sort of like, I imagine that if you're really infirm, you know, it's kind of like you're not here. You know, you're dealing with that. You're not smelling the roses. You're not dealing with your grandchildren. You're not dealing with your, or children, or whatever the case may be. You're not dealing with your, you're not having an attitude of gratitude. I mean, that's all for the young, right? I mean, you can have an attitude of gratitude in your struggle, though. It kind of, there's not much left of you to really know whether or not you're appreciating something or not, whether you have gratitude. And there's not enough of you there to actually know that you are or are not, if you know what I mean, those of you who've been through it. And, it's, well, I suppose it goes with the territory. Eli was barking at some coyotes early, so I seized the opportunity to continue. And I know I need to make sure I get the rest, obviously, and that will... and I will deal with that. What I'll do is I will catch up like I did yesterday, but it didn't really improve my mood. It was almost like I had a glimpse of life that was completely negative in the sense that it was all about vengeance. That, and then I just saw all the people working for the New World Order, for all this stuff, to be sold out to Satan formally, structurally and formally, therefore initiated, accepted, taken the oath, taken the vow. And they all have each other's backs, you know, whether even if they don't like each other, against the rest of the world. And then I saw that it's not about depopulation. It's not about genocide. It's not about the stupid Georgia Guidestones, which is, if you believe that, I got some swampland on the moon for you. Not about that at all. It's about the torture. It's about the vengeance against, you know, those who haven't given up. Because those who went with the devil, who went with Satan, formally, structurally, but then and then proclaim he doesn't exist. And I don't know what you're talking about. You're just crazy. You're one of those crazy wacko Christian people. And that's the way they do it. When you finally press them, you know, when they're the pro, you know, life, pro-abortion and all that, you find out they're Satanists. I think Alex Jones had a video where the woman was talking all about human rights and black rights and the rights of the mother to choose and all this stuff. And then after pressing them enough, she finally comes out and goes, you know, that she worships the devil, she belongs to Satan, and she kills her children. She screams proudly and loves it. And you'll find that all of them have to be in that category because nobody just, you might, when you're young, have an abortion, you know what I mean, because they convince you. But it should do something to your soul where you realize you did something wrong, right? And then you eventually find out what it is. And you eventually find out what side is pushing that. Because the abortions are all sacrifices to the devil, you know, every single one. Well, there may be the case of the mother or whatever, but that was very rare. You know, in general, they tell you, you don't need to know that. But you see, the religion that they're in, they practice very, very fervently, much more than Christians do. And they know what it means. It doesn't matter what I think. That's what they think. And they want a steady supply of late-term abortions, I mean, is before they also feed on the power of it. And like I say, if you get one in a room, if you waterboard one, get a confession out of them, they'll say they worship Satan. I'm just saying. And I'm sure that they thought I'd be doing this podcast this morning. Since when we deal with that, we're dealing with the airwaves, right? We're dealing with a hive mind in the case of the group of these people. They're very intelligent as a hive mind because they're able to pick up your thoughts, understood? So that's how they can gang stalk you, because they pick your thought. They go, oh, there's one. I would advise y'all to watch the Nicole Kidman version of Invasion of the Body Snatchers, or even the old original version, if you want to see what we're talking about. You know, it's a great example. But as the Lord says, there are wheat and tares, right? And so therefore, the Lord preserves his own in the midst of all this. In fact, makes a table for them, Psalm 23, in the midst of the enemy. But it is very much a war going back and forth. I mean, all of politics, to me, I see now, painfully so, as a spiritual war. In other words, the people on Satan's side, it's very easy to see them. And the people on God's side, they may not even know they're on God's side, but you can see them too. And it's very easy to see their behold. For example, the most informing or instructive thing I've seen lately was the Republican debate. And both of them, you know, because we had... it's very interesting, since I publicly tweeted I'm done with Carly Fiorina or whatever, I'm not on the list. I got no more of the spam. I mean, they actually saw that and took me off it because I, you know, had been there early. But they were just fine to move on. I just a side note, no, there's no more. I mean, it's weird. It's like every day there'd be 3 or 4 emails, you know, support Carly. Can you chip in $5? Or, you know, that kind of thing, you know. And it just ended. So apparently I did get through. And they went and took it upon themselves to stop spamming me, which means that did affect them, my withdrawing. Well, I've come to the conclusion that this person's just a sellout. And I saw them do it on live TV. And I couldn't believe it, and I was heartbroken, and that's what was wrong with me for a couple of days. I really was. Oh, I know, don't put your faith in man. I understand all that, okay? What I'm dealing with at this point is, do you want to live 2 more years, or would you like to, you know, see your kids grow up? I mean, it's coming down to that. So it's a little bit more important than just your opinion of politics. It's almost now, it is now a life and death situation. And if we get killed, you know what? You saw what happened, didn't you? You may not even be able to articulate it. You saw them come in, you saw them take everything, and you saw them kill you. And you saw that nobody around you did anything. Nobody raised a voice. No one did a thing. And it just happened right on cue. And you're going to be a witness to that, darn it. No, you're not killed for your Christian testimony. No. No, you're not overcome by the word of your testimony and overcome as in Revelation 7 or 14 or whatever. You're not, no, that's not you. No, I'm sorry, you can't claim that. No, you get killed, you cannot claim that. You will not claim that because it's not exclusive to you or your religion. It's not because of the word of your testimony. It's not because the Antichrist overcomes you or the beast overcomes you. Not at all. It just is. But, well, I mean, it's because it's not because you're a particular kind of person or beholden to the Lord or not. It's just part of the process of the barbarization of the world on purpose by a few social engineers. And as Brother Thomas said, the people are helpless to do anything. They will not do anything. They will sit there and be killed. When they come in, they'll kneel down and they'll just say, okay, go ahead and take me. I'm softened up pretty good. And that's what all the softening up is, so that you'll comply. Look, yesterday was my heart, you know, my lament, okay? Why, Lord? Oh, why, what such a waste? Why have a place like this? So beautiful at first sight and so many possibilities and so wonderful, but yet a hellhole. Why? Ultimately, a hellhole is 80% that. But why do that? I mean, a hellhole because of man and man only. Lovely man. Lovely. Lovely human. Lovely. Great job, human. You don't deserve a planet. You don't deserve to live. And by the way, it's going to kill them too. The people that you think that think they're elite and they're over you, they're going down the tubes as well. So don't feel it's so bad, you know. It's not going to be them living in the fields of Elysium with robots serving them and you're gone. And too bad, you shouldn't have even come here, you know, jerk. You know, versus the most odd thing in the world, the Lord lifting up the foolish things to confound the wise, Donald Trump. Capitalism. Constitution, conservatism, military, whatever, you know. I don't even know what you want to call it, but I mean, versus surviving. And again, this doesn't matter what your economic strata is, how much money you have or you don't have. It doesn't matter. It's when if the thing goes to like a World War III thing, because that's what they want to do for depopulation or any other kind of thing, they're throwing everything in the book at you. See my objection yesterday. I feel so alone. You know, I see everything happening and it's nowhere to go. I tune on the radio, they don't talk about any of it, and I just feel like, well, don't you realize? And I don't know what they think on the tube. I don't know what they think. I don't know what they think on YouTube either. I go to all these conspiracy people. They don't have a clue what's going on either. It's just this Jade Helm. It's, you know, what are we going to do? Nobody knows anything. And that I will back up. I will stand firm on that fact, or at least let me say it. Nobody knows anything. Not on YouTube, not on Podosphere, nobody in media, nobody knows anything. So we are alone, each one of us. We know what's happening, but we can't communicate it. Because it's, you know, it just, you can rant and rave and you sound like a lunatic. But somewhere, you know, there has to be the Lord. Now, I take it to the Lord, you know, I don't yell at them anymore, really. I mean, you know, whether it's Obama and Martha's Vineyard with the billionaires, I mean, you know that. That doesn't look too good. You know, they think they're going to be the elites and the survivors, and they don't even have a seat at the table for the next round, should they get their way, which I don't think they will. And I think there'll be a change of the guard. I think things do change. You know, see, here's the thing. I just watched my neighbor, you know, kind of over a very short period of time, not even know who she is. You know, being 70, in her 70s, happened so quickly, and her family had to intervene, and it was, you know, that's life over, pretty much. And it was really sad. And they liked to play the game. They had it, you know, they had all that going. And so we didn't really get along because of that. Because they were objecting to our not wanting to play that little game. So, of course not. I mean, with me, I'm a straight shooter. It's like what you see is what you get. You know, I'm not going to have some kind of double-minded game going on. Which is, you know, I mean, the world does, but I don't, you know, I'm not into games. But that was the divide, you know. That was the, you know, wrong side. I don't know what's going to happen now. The sad thing was there were criminals that sort of moved in and got her confidence. They took all her, drained all her bank accounts, all her money. She was in debt, writing bad checks, couldn't pay her mortgage. You know, and her daughter just found out all about this just recently. Well, we didn't know either, you know, but this whole thing had happened just like with so many of my old friends. It had the same kind of thing happen, and with my father's friends. And these were all people that, again, when they were younger, I mean, I say this to instruct you, to help you now. I don't say it to have a pissing contest because I'm not... That's not the way we work. I'm saying it so that you can go with the Lord. Go with God. Live. Eternal life. Live. Don't sink on this Titanic death ship. You know, those that played the game, you know, and thought it was so cool when you're young and all that, now, you know, bankrupt and you're losing your minds and infirm and all the rest of it. It was just a trick. But you still have another play left. Don't just be like so many old people and sit on it and squander the opportunity. By all means, accept the Lord Jesus as your only hope and it's the only way. Your own spirit will tell you. And go with him in whatever that, you know, means to you. Now, the Lord put a Bible in my hand. You know, so that's like putting Jesus in my hand. And then that kind of, you know, so I've always danced with the one who brung me. You know, that's the King James Bible, Jesus, the Lord. You know, that's my framework. But I don't know how you approach it. I'm just saying that's, I looked at all the religions of the world. I don't know any other way out of this matrix, out of this time-space cube continuum we're in. I don't know any other way to escape it in death. To me, it seems like you get recycled. You know, into suffering and pain and suffering and again and again, unless you are saved. But most people that embrace the world, like the Steppenwolf, you know, born to be wild, take the world in a love embrace. Everyone I've seen that's done that has wound up, you know, broken in sorrow, which is okay. The whole point is in that state, reaching for the Lord. Now, yes, you heard me questioning God yesterday, like Job did, and I did. You know, why this, Lord? You know, why? Because I'm perceiving people that are dying that don't know anything about anything, and they just seem to have been tortured their whole lives and then dead. And I just wonder, well, was that because of something they did before? I'm trying to understand. Did they do something before? Is that because they inherited? Well, then why not show them that they obviously are connected to Adam in the fall of man with the serpent, which is Satan, and they embrace the satanic thing. So their eyes were open. Okay, so fine, okay. And you know, in other words, they were initiated in Satanism, right? No, they were pure. Oh, how could they be pure after they fell? They can't be. So therefore, everyone inherited that from them, so therefore it's just hell, because it's the serpent or Satan, and his realm is hell, right? Is that what it is? So there is that. But then there's also going with the Lord. Now, i.e., you know, do we want to go around another? Do we want to keep on with this, people? The reason I know it's supernatural, that it's not natural, meaning it's not an organic thing, and there is no organic life here on Earth at all. It's all being manipulated. But the reason is because the things that happen are so far beyond human comprehension and beyond logic that they prove to me a supernatural element behind the scenes manipulating everything. That's right. So I have to basically be beholden to the Lord. Say, Lord, which way? Like today, now I'm obviously, he comforted me, and then now I'm here, I'm back again a few hours later, on call, by the way, ready to go. And I have a whole all day schedule booked in the studio today, so there's that. And we'll see if we can do it, you know, rather than, you know, hopefully we'll make some progress. Oh, that's right. There's the truck being worked on. Yeah, I had a pack rat in there under the truck, and the pack rat chewed some wire, so that's why the check engine light went on. And so I've got that, and I had to have a tune-up, and I don't think I did everything I really wanted to do, and I'm going to have to call them and maybe have schedule some more stuff, because there was like a mildewy smell out of the air conditioner, and if there's any filter in that thing, I want those filters replaced, you know. And so I'm kind of trying to restore the truck. I mean, it's been a good thing over the last, you know, few years, and it's no reason to, you know, not have it. It's just whatever. Anyway, I've got to go get it. Yeah, then I'm gonna take it over to a custom place. I just need to get some new shocks, another muffler, check a couple things that aren't working right, another air raid filter, and then I'd say we're back in business. You know, it's been a great truck. It's the Dodge Ram 1500 that I customized years ago with the lift and the, you know, muffler and exhaust and all the stuff, you know, that guys like to do with trucks. Anyway, it's just been fantastic for where we live. But here's the thing. They're chip sealing the road now, so it's not going to be a dirt road anymore, just a rough and run with big ditches on the side. So he had to have that truck to be able to get out of here, you know, with the big tires and whatnot. And now it's going to be a little more sophisticated. But when it does snow, it's still going to pile up. You won't see the road, because they don't come out here and clean it away. They leave us too far away, which is fine with me being far away. But it just got to thinking, you know, this lady next door, who is from, you know, Los Angeles, from a similar background, just older as me, and to see her there and then taken advantage of by a bunch of people, especially this criminal guy, and really ripped off, and, you know, she still thought she had money and you know, people working for her, and she had to take care of that. Because she took care of this big house all by herself. You know, it's enough for a family to live in, with having horses and, you know, a caretaker, you know, around, and, you know, guest houses, and just all kinds of space. And you know, she was had to be taken out of here and told that she didn't have any more money. And Doja, our cleaning gal, she's also a house sitter for us. She didn't get paid for a month. She worked there a month without pay. And, you know, it was just a weird thing, you know, and it was just people are talking about it because it just seemed to be such a tragic thing. And then I realized that, you know, when I look back at my own peer group, and we're, you know, another 10 years younger, I suppose, but I see things like that happening to them and all of it, you know, in this case too. It's, you know, a decision was made earlier on to embrace or to go with the world system. And, you know, you see the toll, it takes a toll. Look, you may not believe me, but it is that, and mainly that, that takes the toll on people. Now, that doesn't mean that someone in Christ couldn't get, you know, dementia. I'm not saying that. You know what I mean? I'm just saying that, well, in this case, it just seemed like real punishment. I mean, just, you know, kind of ridiculous. And I've seen it happen with people. They get divorced, you know, later on, and they have to go to each other's funerals, which starts to be more of a prevalent thing. And what they had for retirement runs out, typically. You know, they think they've got it made, but then there's, you know, the whipsawing of the market makes it almost impossible because of the corrupt people that are involved that there's no regulation for and no tax. They don't pay taxes either. They just play with people's lives and destroy them, and then they laugh about it in the elevator at Goldman Sachs or wherever they are. And I'm just so sorry. It's like, you know, why, Lord? See, I can see the heart of evil, how dark and deep it really is. And that is something no one should ever see. And I kind of wish I couldn't see it. But I see everything. I try to shield my eyes, but I'm just an instrument like that. I'm a very sensitive instrument. I'm kind of like the Richter scale thing, a little seismometer. And I get it all, and I don't want it. I want my pure heart back. How can I get it back when I keep looking at this? So if it's so great, Z, then, you know, I don't want to go over there. Because, look, you're on your side. I'm not on any side. I'm on the side of life. To me, there's only one side in this fight. Life or death, but death is no option. It's not a side. It just means you're in spin cycle. You're just going to be, you haven't had enough pain and suffering, so you need a few more lifetimes of it. If that's how it breaks down, fine. How about 100,000 more lifetimes of it? You know, go ahead. Don't listen to me then. But you'll be sorry you didn't. But, you know, I don't know. Who am I to say? I obviously have gone through my share. And a lot of the time probably didn't repent. Maybe I did. I don't know. I don't know anymore. Because I look at myself, I don't see it really good. And I don't see it totally evil. But it's just kind of, you'd think I could be more pure. It's just terrible. But at least, you know, I have a conscience. And it's intact. And I know what I've done wrong. And, you know, I'm confessing, I'm admitting it, you know, and that's what has kept me, that awareness has kept me from, you know, asserting myself as a, you know, the P word, a prophet of the Lord or this or that. I can assert nothing. I just, you know, I understand. But see, I believe in a sense, even with all that, and even with my day yesterday, how it feels to talk to God and say, why this? When you know, that's almost like, you know, that's an affliction. But even with all the affliction and all the, you know, oppression and different things that happen, I wouldn't trade it for the world. I want to make sure I tell you that today. I could have a day like yesterday every day of my life. I'm still going to, I have no place to go but the Lord, you see. I want to live. And somehow if he has me the challenge I have, you know, everyone has different challenges, is being too sensitive, kind of, you know what I mean? That makes me a pretty good musician and good in the studio and, you know, good with the arts and things. And there's a lot of that kind of stuff. You know, other people have, you know, other challenges. They might have a health challenge that I've certainly had my share of those, but I'm deciding now to really go for the gusto here. You know, I'm really going to look, I don't care when I die. I had to contemplate my own mortality just thinking about what happened to the lady next door, you know, that lived down the way there, you know, across the way. And I realized that, gosh, I saw Roddy Piper go, it's my age, you know, and I'm like, okay, you know, you come to that, you know, you'd be a fool not to think about that and to think about, well, what are you going to do about it? You know what I mean? Is this a great place to be when you're old? Say you're old and alone out here. And as what I saw, I'd say, no, not really. Out here, you know, in the country, you get jackals, right? People that are like jackals. They're always looking for to scam somebody. You know, you have rural stuff like that that doesn't go on. It goes on in the city, too, but it's not the same, right? And there's no easy way. As long as they're human beings, it's going to be torture, right? You have children, you're tortured. You have, you get married, you're tortured, right? You have a birthday party, it's torture. You go see the game, it's torture because it ends. You see the movie, it's torture when it ends. You go out to dinner, it's torture because it ends. It's like we're biding time, whistling by the graveyard, where this big thing is happening, and no one is dealing with it, including me. I'm not dealing with it all the time. You know, I like to escape. That's one of my big problems. I always want to delve into fantasy and things, and that's why I do music I do. Hey, did any of you get, because my friend told me, he said, you know, does anyone understand you about, you know, the music I do? Now, the DCP music, we understand. It's all very, you know, that makes, but I mean, when I go off and do my own thing, I mean, because he was saying he understands it, but maybe, you know, you know, if you say 10% of the world population, maybe what we mean is 0.005 or something. Am I just really in my own world? I mean, did you get that of the sea? And I got enamored with that idea for a while. And I mean, did that, and then we did some things, and we did something with Kelly Become, and then Mine, I Breathe the Sea. Did that, because he was saying that makes no sense to people, whatever you're trying to say. Or like the 1789 piece, you know, the La Revolution, the French thing. Did that not make sense? Or well, I felt the parallel was, you know, exact. And I felt the idea of going into the sea. You see, when a species feels so put upon and so to survive, they might develop gills and fins, you know, just to survive, because the survival instinct is so strong. And if they have to go into the sea, then so be it. Creatures have come out of the sea. Creatures have gone into the sea. Why wouldn't it be with a? Why couldn't a human do that? So that's all. Yeah, you know, I could have just as well been, and then, you know, Mars is another thing. I don't know why I'm obsessed with Mars. I'm not obsessed with Mars, but it keeps coming back in. I'm always watching these things, wondering about it, too. I do my creations in the studio. I wonder what I'm talking about, too. Why this, why now? But then I've learned it. I don't know, with me, I just kind of go with it anyway, because I'm just interested in, I don't want to see where it goes. I'll always be like that with things. I've always been like that. It doesn't need to make sense to me. It's I'm being sensitive to something pulling me along, and I, you know, for better or for worse. But I'm always interested in what's next, because it now seems that my life, this podcast, the music, everything seems to be in some kind of a story stream. You know, so I'm also looking to the next chapter. I mean, what's next? And I'll tell you where it's going, ultimately. It's going to where there's going to be a critical mass with the spiritual realm. where there's going to be interaction with angels and UFOs and the whole bit. Yeah, it's all going to open up. I know it. Everyone's been trying to stop me from that. And they do it in the name of Jesus. You know, this is what happens. They come around and go, oh, Zeph, you're going to have to, you know, just understand it's all dealt with. God's got it all. It's no need to look over there, Zeph. No need to go over here. No need to go out that way. It's all outside the will of God. And believe me, I'm not obsessed with UFO thing. I mean, it's just that the whole mystery of it all is going to be unveiled, because I won't settle for anything. It's just my very nature. So I say, look, my DNA is my DNA. There's nothing I can do about it. You know, you keep your crap to yourself and quit trying to correct me or correct my thinking or minister to me. I'm not interested. I have a destiny that's unfolding. And that destiny is huge. And it involves the very nexus point of all things. So that's a little bit huge. You probably have nothing like that or wouldn't even consider anything like that, because you have a puny little mind and a puny little future, and you have no present. And so the only thing you can do is go on the internet and find people to try to control. Well, not this one. I'm sorry, whoever that was that received that, I'm sorry to say puny future. No future is puny, but you know what I mean. You're very small-minded, and you feel like you need to bring people down by controlling them. That's just no good. You know, maybe you could learn something by people. You know, people have destinies, and you can't control them all and make everyone homogenous in your own little understanding of what everything is. And keep, you know, trying to correct everybody and everybody that, you know, all people, then you and what, two other people have this cosmic view of what's happening. And that's fine that you have a cosmic view of what's happening, but that doesn't necessarily mean, that you have a, that's got anything to do with me. And you say that, so yes, I've said I wanted to bust open this matrix thing and all that, you know, and I said, I see things, you know, and you're like, well, that's not necessary. It's already handled, see? It's like, no, I have my destiny. This is who I am. So I've had to break a lot of those chains, folks. I mean, you didn't realize there's so many people like that. I must be speaking to hundreds of people right now like that, and they all want to control you. You know, they don't want you to go out there and do anything, or you know, they want everyone to be in this little thing where they tell you what's going on, and you're supposed to just nod and accept it. When I'm talking about a whole destiny unfolding, I mean, I'm talking about marvelous things out there, you know, that we see glimpses of, but we never get to really see it. It's kept from us, but it's not always going to be that way. And, you know, I say, trust Jesus. Well, I trust Jesus, and that's how Jesus is unfolding my destiny. Since I trust Jesus, that I'm unfolding. If I wasn't trusting Jesus, maybe I would be bottled up. But didn't you ever wonder about what this is? Anyway, no, I can't sit by and just be content following the bouncing ball and going, I'm just can't wait for the rapture. I can't wait for Jesus to, how about this? I'm just waiting for death, because then I'm really going to see something. Well, I'm not going to die then. I'm just going to become myself, which is an eternal being, and just show everybody then. Anyway, nothing less than that level will satisfy, and if it doesn't reach that level, I don't care. But it will. And they can't stop me from my unfolding destiny, but they've been trying and see my whole, it seems more what's going on isn't so much punishment for being who you are. It's also prevention from accomplishing what you're meant to accomplish. And I found that the greatest policemen are Christians, policing people so they never advance. And I am just so sick and tired of it, I can't even tell you. The last thing I was studying up on was the rapture, the pre-trib rapture, of course, and watching. I went through all the evidence one more time. Well, I just, Trish had a website on her laptop, and I looked at it, and it had news articles, and then it had a page about, you know, the whole thing about the pre-trib rapture and all the aspects of it in the Book of Revelation and the whole thing. And, you know, they had all worked out who the two witnesses are and, you know, the Daniel 70 weeks, right? And then how, you know, and all those things that, you know, more of a fundamentalist point of view, right? Kind of a Bible-thumping point of view. I'm trying to say that without putting them down. And they make a point. They go, well, you know, see with the two witnesses, obviously, the one who shuts off the rain is Elijah, which, of course, we know from the Old Testament because he shut off the rain with Ahab. Then we understand that the one who brings all the signs and wonders, you know, and things like that would be Moses because he did that in the sight of Pharaoh. So it all makes sense what they're saying. You know, and then they go to Thessalonians and Paul saying, you know, caught up in the air and the last trump. And all the things that Jesus will rescue the church. And that's all fine and good. It's all mathematically worked out and it all really is very convincing until I factor in the persecution of Christians today and how they're not getting raptured. And I'm like, at what level? Is it just what America is being? And then they talk about the Great Tribulation and how it lasts 7 years. And it's tribulation for 7 years, but the Great Tribulation is the last 3.5 years. And during the tribulation, I suppose, or I guess before that is the rapture. So they don't believe the rapture started. They talk about the temple, the rebuilt temple in Jerusalem. They talk about, you know, all the stuff we've been through for years. And I kind of forgotten it, but I was sort of refreshed. Not real strong, but just kind of, in, you know, about like I say, the two witnesses and, you know, how people have their different theories. And it's like, but if you look at the way they put it, and you had, you know, the shut off the rain guy and the signs and wonders, right? You know, that has the parallel to the Old Testament. And then they die and then they're resurrected. And how Moses was resurrected. Some people think it's Enoch because Enoch hasn't died. He got translated. I'm like, oh, lots of people get translated without death. Jesus said there are some here who won't see death. What's your point? They don't know what death is, my point. And they never will, and you're wrong, and you always will be. But you're too hard-headed to see it. You're too much, what you see is what you touch and what you feel. It's all about you, so you're never going to get this. I don't mean to be so testy and angry. I'm sorry. It's just that I'm a little frustrated because, you know, I see the time is short, and I see that if we could just make some changes, we might have more time. And my frustration is that people seem hell-bent on self-destruction. So, and there's nothing I can do about it. I'm going to probably die with them. I don't want to, you know. No, correct that. I won't die. I'm sorry, Lord. You told me I'm not going to die, so I won't. Well, we got things to do. I've got, you know, there's a whole other, you know, I have my own destiny that unfolds. You have yours. I'm sure yours is as spectacular as mine is. Mine is spectacular, though. I've been kept low for a long time, so, you know, low meaning, you know, it's like, you know, you could, if you do prophesy something, you don't get no credit, Zev. Yeah, I understand, that's the Lord keeping us low, right? Lest we boast and blow it all, yes? Well, of course it's right for the Lord to keep me down like that. I say hallelujah, that's a blessing, not a curse, because it keeps me from, you know, doing what I probably would do, which is just go off into egomania territory. So, you know, this prevents it. Now as I get older, less tendency to do that, so the reins might come off a little bit, you know. In fact, certainly they will. Anyway, so you're tuning in because you're anticipating something, you know, not what I've said exactly, but you see something up ahead through this podcast and through this little journey we're on, you know, and it's really, you know, you see something for yourself, and that's why you tune in here. I mean, that has to be it. And, you know, I haven't bought into all these theories. I read them like I did a scripture study yesterday, and I went through these scriptures, and I'm like, you know, but at the end of the day, it just doesn't mean that. And then people tell me, well, it's all about the internal world of Jesus. I'm like, that just sounds stupid. And then the exterior people are stupid. No, that doesn't. It's the interior and exterior. Well, how about it's multidimensional and, like, you know, you get glimpses here and there, but nobody really has the whole answer. They sure don't. You know, I would watch very carefully. Well, because what, you know, for example, this guy talking about Daniel's 70 weeks and what he's talking about, well, a lot of this stuff should already have been fulfilled already, if going strictly by that timeline, and it hasn't been. So what are you going to do? They have to have Obama as the Antichrist. And if he's the Antichrist, the seals have had to have been opened and done away with already, because that's the beginning of tribulation are the seals, right? And the end of the tribulation are the seven trumpets, the seven vials, and the seven bowl judgments, right? You know, the 777. Then you have the seven seals, right? And the seventh one being the thunders, and, you know, the being quiet about what the seven thunders, and then that's really announcing the Great Tribulation. And then the Great Tribulation has all these events happening, and people try to tie it in with the Old Testament, with the book of Daniel and 70 weeks, and also any other prophecy, and they, you know, torturously put it all together. And, you know, finally, when you look at it, you go, yes, but you see, the problem is that you're running out of time. These things should have ought to have been happening already. So they say, no, they're already doing the temple sacrifices, which signifies the tribulation when they start doing that. Can't even have a tribulation without them doing that, according to these people. Now, it's not me. The Lord is not going to make me so sure in my own understanding. You see, he's not going to give me that. No. He's not going to give me that because, you know, you run into that with people, and it becomes like a mind control thing. The Lord wants me to be, you know, loose, creative, you know, ready to move, whatever way. You know, in other words, I have to go, like I question, I say, Lord, why this? I get shown absolute evil. I get shown to it through my cells. I'm watching all through my limbs. I'm feeling it all, and I can't feel anything else. You know what I mean? I can't see the sky. I can't see the stars. I can't see the sun. I can't see the plants. All I can do is feel what I'm feeling. And there's nothing else. There's no room for anything else. Why this, Lord? The idea, what he showed me yesterday, I guess, through horrible process, was pain, but vengeance. And in fact, he confirmed, yes, vengeance for having been born upon the earth. Therefore, you are to be tortured if you join the other sign. Then you get off the hook for a while, but it comes back when you get older. And then you have no defense. So at least if you go through it and you don't make it or whatever, at least you'll go with the Lord, right? But you might ask, well, why this gauntlet? Why do we have to be here and go through this? And I have to tell you, the doctrine of original sin just isn't good enough. It's pretty damn flimsy. Well, Adam fell, so you see. No. I'm sorry. there's so many people dying, they have no clue what they did wrong, or, you know, they don't even know what you're talking about. Well, that's why I said, we got to get them the gospel. The gospel means good news. Your news is bad news. If you don't do this, this will happen to you. That's your news. That's no news at all. Certainly that's no gospel. You're preaching whatever it is you're preaching. It ain't no gospel, man. You know, you're going to have to go look in the mirror and take a good hard look at how much you've done that kind of twisting manipulation to control people versus how much truth has come out of your mouth. And we do get preachers from the 501c3 from time to time. Usually they go running off screaming. You know, but it's redounded to people like me to, you know, to... Because if I don't say something to them, no one will, right? Because they're in a lofty position. So a lowly person says something. If they take it to heart, they could improve things, but usually they don't. They keep on with the status quo, which we saw in Fox News. They do the same thing in the churches. And the people suffer. And the nation suffers. And it's their fault. And I guess they just wring their hands at night, or I don't know what they do. I don't know how they could live with themselves. I would find that very difficult. If I was responsible for a lot of people, and I had to stand before the Lord and say, yeah, I mind-controlled them and manipulated them into believing all this stuff to make sure their asses stayed glued to those pews and those coffers stayed full. So I had to play ball with the devil in order to keep those coffers full. Otherwise, the devil was going to be taken away from me. So not necessarily. You're just not giving God a chance, are you? You don't trust God to keep the coffer full, do you? No, they've all sold out to the devil, all these, you know, 501c3s, because they believe the coffer wouldn't be full with Jesus, but it would be full with the devil. Well, that right there is the unforgivable sin. Pretty much, I mean, in a way, right? I wouldn't want to get any closer to that nexus point than that, would you? Though you say Jesus has no power, but the devil does? Would you really want to say that to your congregation and say that's why you have to remain conformed to the world so that we can keep the coffers full to keep this organization alive for Jesus? Are you really going to play that game? That's the unforgivable, that's the unpardonable sin right there. That's it. No, I wouldn't want to be any of these preachers. No, my heart goes out to them. I understand they came up through the university system. They got their divinity degree. By the time they got that degree, they were already ruined, already not in any way, shape, or form fit to lead a church, let alone a Boy Scout brigade. Okay, and yet here they are, having handed over the entire nation to the devil. Would you want to be standing before the Lord with that on your hands? Oh, they're pushing for ecumenicalism now, Christian and Islam being merged. I mean, they'll do it, one world religion, all that stuff. You know, you'll see them all doing it. You know, they'll be the first to, the first thing they're going to do is, you know, it's one thing to put the gay marriage in there and to get the, someone was showing me how they had the, churches were all open up to, they're all going completely gay. Because the gay thing is, it's either all or nothing. You can't have a few, you know, everything has to be changed. Bathrooms have to be changed, you know, construction has to be done. Because of how evil man is. It's the sickest thing I've ever seen, and I've just dropped out from that. I want nothing to do with it. But you know, these are not churches. They're activism hall. They're for worship of man. But see, I'm just waiting for the polygamists to get in there. The of course, you have to marry children and adults, because that's got to be. You can't be prejudiced against pedophiliacs. In the future, that's going to be legal, and that they all have to have rights. And robots, you should be allowed to marry a robot too. So we need robot rights. I mean, this has opened the door for all of it. And believe me, all of it will come. I'm just waiting. When the world's in flames, I want some of you to tell me, Jesus, you were right. we're in flames and suffering now because we just couldn't stop. You write about the church. You write about the political using sexual proclivities as a political battering ram. You write about the fascism. You write about the whole thing, and now billions are dead. You write about that too. Well, then my answer to that would be, then why, when I was telling you about all these things, and written word and spoken word and music and everything, how come you kept on with it? Because we thought you were wrong. It wasn't ever going to happen to us. I even told you that if you keep on that course, that when you get older, it's going to come back on you, you know, as if you, you know, and it's going to be like retribution, and you're going to feel it's unfair. But it won't be unfair, because if you look, you'll see how you were part and parcel, albeit by proxy, of, you know, evil murders and wars and poverty and, you know, imposed poverty and all the rest of the social ills, that you've actually been fomenting it by your association and affiliation with the world system. From having taken the world in a love embrace, you now are on the hook as a defendant before the Lord for every wrong thing that's ever happened here, every bad, horrible atrocity that's ever been committed against human beings. It's as if you did them yourself. Now, I know you don't want that on your head, because that will make you go infirm, senile, whatever. So how about accepting the Lord and just trying some... The Lord will cleanse your guilt. It may take a while. I mean, for me, it took a lot of years. I had guilt from just thinking, I'm here alive on the earth, and I've caused all these problems, this Satanist would tell me. You've caused all these problems and all this pain and suffering for all these people, you know. So I felt guilty all the time. You know, they just wanted to blame me for everything that ever happened. They tend to do that. That's what the Inquisition was all about. They'd be burning the lambs at the stake, right? Saying they're the evil witch. Blaming them for all the society's ills, yes? The ones that never did anything. The ones who were innocent. Why they do that? Well, I'm not innocent now. I mean, you know, during the time I didn't understand what they were talking about. They were just kept piling on. I'm like, well what exactly did I guess, what, do you want me to just die? Yes, we do. Why? Again, the answer is vengeance. It's vengeance, folks. It's vengeance for having been born and existing as, you know, I guess one of God's kids. I can't think, even though I was in rebellion toward God, you know, I guess I was perceived as that because I didn't belong to, you know, the devil. So, vengeance against the Lord through his children. Isn't that what the whole world's about? All politics and everything is about vengeance? Isn't it all about vengeance? Everything on earth? Isn't it all 100% vengeance against humanity for having been made by God? Isn't that it? And those who quit running the race, who give up, sell out, you know, to be with the enemy, they become like the enemy, you know, exacting pain and torture and death on people, feeling that they're doing God service, they're doing God's will, getting rid of the evil people who are the lambs, who never hurt anybody yet, because they, you know, God bless them, they're pure hearts. They would feel too guilty to hurt anyone. But they go after them, and they go after, you know, they still go after Christians, even though a lot of the Christians are corrupt, they still go after them. But who's going after who? aren't these people completely possessed? And they're doing, I mean, because they don't have a cause for vengeance against their fellow man, do they? No, they don't. Well, who does? Well, that's what's possessing them. I rest my case, Your Honor. I mean, it can't get more, can it get more clear than that? I mean, did I, once again, in God's court of law, prove beyond all doubt what reality is and what we're facing here? Right, there's no reason for vengeance unless you take it back to the creation itself. Then you have a reason for vengeance, which explains ever all the atrocities and all the pain and suffering that you see, and all the perversions and all the, you know, perverting God's word and inverting all the things that he holds virtuous and all the things he's trying to instruct us on and the way to behave in a society if you want that society to continue. And instead, it's all being inverted. In other words, doing the thing that's against God is great. That's really the mark of a free society, when in actuality, it leads to complete mass genocide, mass death. And what I've tried to do is warn people about this so that in the future, they, you know, if you're going to die, you go ahead and go, yep, it's my fault and I'm doing it. Yes, I love it. So that you don't whine and complain about it. Because you made it all happen by your affiliation association. So Jesus will break you of that legally so that you're no longer on the hook for that whole thing. That's the point I was trying to make. That's what salvation is. Part of it's a legal contract with God, i.e., you break that contract. You're not on the hook for all the evils that man has done. You come and you're washed clean by the blood of Jesus Christ, so you stand innocent again before God. And God takes you, and the breach is the gap is closed, and you go off with the Lord and escape this thing, because if you keep getting recycled in this thing, it's just more pain and torture for you every time. Here's the real pain and torture. You think you're going to make it. You think you're going to win the game. You think it's going to work out, and then it doesn't. It's not just you. You can multiply this by every single human being on earth. It just doesn't add up in the end. You know, what's promised you just never comes. You know, the whole born to be wild, fist in the air thing turned out to be a ruse. It just turned out to be another gimmick to reel them in and then flush them. F them, torture them, kill them. And, you know, we let the people that serve the beast, they get to live a little while longer without being pummeled, but then they get pummeled in the end anyway. They just get to go another, you know, a few more rounds around the track and act like they beat the game, right? Those poor fools that don't know what's going on, look, they're getting pummeled. I'm not. And then, of course, they're next to be pummeled after their utility is over. Because they're useful in hurting other people. They're used to hurt and harm and corral other people for mass slaughter, which can even include mass conversion is mass slaughter. Since the whole thing is run by a death cult anyway, the cult of which is to kill human beings in any way, shape, or form. How many babies have we aborted here? You think God likes that? And yet nobody, all the conservative Christians in Congress, not one of them does a damn thing. What do you think about that? That's pretty pathetic. You think God's going to bless the nation that has his people supposedly in positions of power and then refuse to do anything? Or, you know, it's just too difficult a problem? And then all these people advocating women's rights, you know, women or a woman's right to choose, right? A woman, it's really a woman's right to murder. It's really everyone's responsibility. It's the guy that impregnated the woman. It's the woman herself. It's the little soul, the little being that's going to be born and needs to be honored for a society to be, because the society that does not honor their children is the society that will collapse. And will kill lots of people, including probably the people that are advocates for women's rights, will die too. And they won't have any more babies, that's for damn sure. Many women that got abortions, were not able to conceive after that because of the damage done by the abortion process. They don't tell you that when they're touting women's right to choose, and the abortion wrecks the woman from ever being able to have children again. Not all the time, but I mean, a good portion, so much so that it's so dangerous that it should be published everywhere. Women are not warned. They bring them in, they need a quota of abortion and Planned Parenthood, so they have to abort enough babies to reach the quota. And now there's a big business and stem cell research and all that. Got to get the tissue. But the tissue is no good if it's harvested too late. You got to harvest it as close to the birth time as possible. You got to actually harvest it while the tissue is pretty much still alive. What's that? Multiply that by about 60, 70 million people. Multiply that by the idea that the entire reason for Planned Parenthood was to eliminate black babies, to eliminate blacks from the population by eugenicist Sanger, Margaret Sanger, a hero of Hillary Clinton. You starting to get the picture now? Starting to understand? Well, you know what Hillary is, right? You know what she is, who she is, who she serves, who they all serve. The UN, her, doesn't matter. Her stupid husband, all the rest of them. Stupid because he's smart enough to figure all this out, and he couldn't do it. He remained reprobate. Why? Doesn't he care about his daughter and her children? I mean, or is he just so into his own trip, he can't see outside his own, obsessive narcissism. I guess that's what it is. Anyway, these people don't give a damn about people. They're like psychopaths. What they want to do is you see, the road to destruction is okay with them. That's why Obama does what he does. It's okay to bring the world to the, right now it's at the brink of World War III again with Russia. You may not know that, but they're not going to publicize it. But they're trying to stoke it up in Odessa, of all places. That's where it's going on. Okay? They're putting American presence there, huge. There's a couple thousand Americans there now. There's going to be more. And that'll probably be a flashpoint. It'll be Odessa, and as it relates to Ukraine and so forth. The people that are promoting, they're saying already, we are in a hot war with Russia right now. They're calling it a hot war. These people are insane and should not have any business to be at the Pentagon or anywhere else. The United States not only aborts the babies, but picks fights that are going to get its people killed, but they don't care about you or anyone. In fact, most of them should be arrested for crimes they've already done. But that's not going to happen, you see. Nobody's going to do anything to help anyone. People say, well, there's good guys in the military waiting for the knight in shining armor. What, a coup d'etat? No, that's not going to happen either. Let me just be able to tell you, nothing is going to happen that's going to help anything or anyone. It's all going to go down the tubes. It's just the question is, how quickly? I'm all for more time. I'm pleading to the Lord, the case for the United States, and that the people here are just ignorant. That must be it. They're just stupid. And, you know, this is a young country. Don't blame, you know, but I'm not making much headway because the Lord informs me that people need to make a conscious decision to reject God and to accept Satan, you know, in high school, you know, in early high school, and earlier and earlier. And for the elites, you know, being trained up when they're 5, 6, and 7 years old so that by 8, they have a rule that by eight years old, they have them, you know, so they have to start in with the ritual abuse and the pedophilia and all that stuff at 5. They have to be fully sexualized so that by 8, because through that sexualization, they get the control and they get the demon possession. And then, you know, by 8, they got them. Then they go out like program robots and do the bidding of the elite to continue this lovely world we have. I'm sorry. You know, you're going through a wave of my negativity. And, you know, I'm sharing my torture with you. What if you had to, like, be there all day long, every day, like, in my head, huh? Would you like that? and see it like that all day long, every day, you'd start crying. I know, and I do. It's so painful to watch. But I have a solution. The solution is the Lord, obviously, but I mean, you know, who's listening? No one, really. Very few. I do think that I, you know, a Twitter tweet had some power. I didn't realize that what I said had power, but I was taken off Carly Fiorina's mailing list by them. I don't think that I put it in spam. I don't think so. I might have, but it looked like they... I got no more of those ever since I made my announcement that I'm dropping her because she sold out to the establishment. And so it's just going to be another... There'd be no difference between her or Hillary in the end. I mean, maybe with Carly you get to World War III a little faster. With Hillary you go broke faster. So it's like, you know, take your pick. Republican and Democrat. Wonderful. And I don't know, I just feel so bad. I'd like to go back to Mars and just forget about all this. I say back to Mars because I think I must have been on Mars at one point or another. And Mars just is a symbol of all outer space. But I just feel like, you know, I can't, you know, I'm having a hard time relating to this situation here. I don't know, why do so many psychiatrists kill themselves? You know, you want to know my opinion on that? It's because, look at the position they're in. To justify this, and then if you got a problem with this, they want to deem you crazy. If you say up is up and down is down and left is left and right is right, and the sun comes up in the east, sets in the west, or the wind is blowing from the south or the north or the east or the west, if you notice anything in, you know, cognition that is accurate, like, you know, yes or no, black or white, whatever, then you're crazy. You have to see it in not just shades of gray, but whatever the prevailing opinion is, or you're crazy. Now, how would that be to uphold that and then use medication to coerce and force people into zombified states so that they will start to understand? I'm not holding up three fingers, I'm holding up four. And so they all have to say four, or else they're going to get medicated. The rise of the psychiatrist. The left cannot exist without psychiatrists because psychiatrists do the devil's bidding. They are little sorcerers in pharmakia land, right? And you need that to be able to get people to lie to themselves and to lie to be in a world of delusion enforced by medication so that they can continue on this fantasy island world of theirs. Where you could have rainbow flags painted on the White House and you can call Putin the evil aggressor and just go start bombing him, and, or any other lie you want to make up. Well, there shouldn't be any flag of someone's personal thing put on the White House, whether it be the gay thing or the, you know, or any other personal flag. All this stuff is completely evil. Completely, 100%. It has to do, I'll tell you why it's there. It's got nothing to do with gays and all that, because they don't care about gays. You just don't understand. They do any kind of sex, any kind of thing. They don't say gay, straight, or whatever. It's just anything is anything. They've always been like that. They use it to, you know, crush any kind of prior social mores, just like destroying old buildings, burning Bibles, you know, getting rid of, you know, churches, anything that's Judeo-Christian. They actually have to destroy all the buildings in the whole world, start over again, and kill every human being too, because, I mean, obviously, right. In other words, the program that they're pursuing isn't their own. Logic is no part of it. It's just about destroying, inverting, changing God's whatever word, anything like that that's an inversion, perversion, whatever of it, to be instituted by law, even if it, oh no, guaranteed it will bring destruction, but the idea is to bring it faster. And then when they go, when they're told they got 2 minutes to live and they see the thing coming over and they see the air burst right there and they understand they're going to be incinerated in about 1 second, they have that moment where they go, oh, you think I had something to do with it? No. No, they never get there. They're just deer in the headlights. Not having a clue that all the people who participated in overturning all the laws, anything, you know, pretty soon, I mean, I'm wondering when they're going to pass the post-abortion thing. Well, it's with the complete cooperation of the Republican Congress, because they haven't done anything about the later and later term abortions. Nothing. The harvesting of baby. I see Indiana has outlawed. They have to either cremate or bury a fetus. Now, that's the new rule in Indiana. But I'm not sure that rule will hold up too long. I mean, this is a Joseph Mengele wet dream here. And yet, there it is. Nazi-esque to the hilt. Same mores that the Nazis had, you know. And yet the people here are, they wonder why are the people, look, a lot of you know everything I'm saying on a visceral kind of, like perhaps not a cognitive level, like I made it very, very kind of matter of fact in a way. But I mean, you know, I'll sense all this stuff, right? And it gives you a feeling of horror and doom, correct? Of, well, what's the use? It's so awful, we're all going to die anyway, and, you know, and then there's the other thing, and we are going to die anyway, and probably before this whole thing happens. I like to say I'm not going to die, but my logical side says, well, probably I will, and, you know, a lot of this may rage on after me. But, again, I will propose the solution is Jesus. I know. But every cult leader in the world has got Jesus too. So that sort of ruins my Jesus. So what do we, I know, I'm silenced again. Every which way you turn. It's, well, you know, it wouldn't be a prison if they didn't have locks and keys. They didn't lock the prisoners in their cells at night, and, right? It wouldn't be much of a prison then. Well, it's a hell of a prison. It's high security. Only people can't see it. Because they're mind controlled with Disneyland, and they keep thinking they're going to win the game one day. I love it when these old rock stars come out for a comeback tour. It's like, dude, your moment passed, man. You know, the most you're going to get is playing some casino somewhere. That's the end of it. You know, but they don't understand. You know, I knew this guy that got a pop as an actor, and he got like 3 films in a row, 4. I know, and I know exactly, you know, the trajectory. I knew it would be 3 or 4 films. And all of a sudden, he just, like, disappeared. You know? And he disappeared to, I think, Malibu. But he's there, unemployed. You know, and he's telling the... This is a couple, 3 years ago, in 2012. He said he's planning on getting back into acting. I'm not going to say who it is, but he's planning on getting back into acting. He's been hanging out with his buddy there, who was a famous, real famous actor, who gets all the roles. And I guess having friends in high places hasn't helped him at all. He's going to go back to Broadway because he feels that plays are the real thing. And then, of course, 3 years later, nothing. You know, it's the same thing. Nothing has happened. So he got what he wanted, you know, very short-sighted, sold out for the Malibu house, you have the kid out there, live in the country, you know, up, not on the beach, but just kind of back in the country a little bit. Because there's like Malibu Creek, and there's, you know, there's some lovely houses back in there and some acreage. And, you know, for this guy, I believe Malibu was a mecca. I was living out there at the time. We stayed there about a year on the bluff over Zuma Beach, and it was really a nice spot. But then I had to move on. You know what I mean? The beach every day. The problem I have with the beach and the ocean and surfing every day was, is this all there is? You know what I mean? You just feel like when you have your session in the water, right, and you come out, and then that's the end of the day. You're tired. You're not going anywhere. And the next day you do it again and again and again. Pretty soon it just becomes that's it. That's your whole life, a blur. I kind of traded surfing for music because in music, it's always a new vista, a new thing, something different. And back when I was a teenager, it's funny, I was a really pretty good surfer. Not great, but, you know, but stylish and, you know, pretty good, you know, just like I would always get good rides and stuff. But then the music thing was, I couldn't do music and surfing at the same time. You know, you had to make a decision. And so I sort of went with music more because it was really my heart, you know. And so I kind of left the beach. And that was the same thing with Malibu. I realized I'm here, you know, kind of surfing every day. Sort of revived it. I was like, you know, my late 30s or whatever. And I kind of got back into it and I started getting good at it again. But then it was like every day just went by like that. And there was something, at that time I was kind of trying to make films and I was writing screenplays and doctoring screenplays and doing things like that. And, you know, kind of in that world and trying to, you know, make a go of it. And it wasn't going very well at all. In fact, I completely failed at it. But thank God for that, right? Because I think the Lord had some other plans. And I remember telling people, you know, if I fail at this, I'm going to kill myself and all that. Well, I failed and I didn't kill myself. And it just wasn't the path. It was a path. The Lord used it to open my eyes to some things. You know what I mean? It had nothing to do with being in the screenwriting thing or the producing or directing or anything. It had to do with opening my eyes to the situation, to the spiritual battle. And it did that. So instead of killing myself, I kind of got aware. It opened my eyes, in a sense. It stole my pure heart. Because I was like, well, why am I failing? Well, go watch the film Anger Management and you'll figure it out. That's the way to move on up. What was the solution there? He had to kiss the girl in front of all those people. is their working metaphor. Fine, you know, great. And Jack Nicholson plays the devil and Adam Sandler plays the loser, right? The lamb who moves up to be a wolf. Which, of course, is really stupid imagery and a really dumb story to frame it that way since it's all based on a lie. I mean, it's true enough, you know, but then ultimately it's still a lie. The idea that there's a way to make it work out here by, you know, dancing with the devil, that's not correct. Back to my point with Malibu and this guy, you know, I'm sorry for the digression, but... you know, but I was there, and that's where I met this young man. Anyway, he I could tell he wanted to be out there when I was there. You know, when I was working with him there, and so eventually he you know, when he hit it, and he hit kind of semi big, not really household name, not really breaking that barrier, but. Just a bit, was in some good stuff and had some money coming in and all that. And so he basically eventually moved there. I was surprised. I saw him once on a bicycle. He would bicycle, you know, everywhere. So I would see him, you know, with his groceries on a bike or whatever. And passed by, just wondered, oh, wow, that's just so interesting. You know, he had designs on that when he was really young. He wanted to move there. Now, here's my point. He had his sights set on this short-term thing, you know, his dream. And he got what he wanted. And now he's sitting out there sort of, you know, gee, now what? The other thing was he was a good musician. And that was his, you know, probably better at that than the acting trade. But it would have been great to make a go of that. But that didn't, you know, that wasn't pursued either. I really don't know what the deal is. But I just saw this sort of waste of a life, you know, because they got what they wanted, you know, they got what they sold out for. And then it just dried up. So it doesn't have to be a long goal. And Frank Whalen and I used to talk about this, you know, where someone would, you know, they'd say, well, this would be the ultimate for me. And they sell out for that. And then after that's over, that's it. Say. And, there's a lot of people in that category, and then they just sit there. Their lives, you know, they don't get rich. They don't get, you know, they're not critical mass. They're kind of eking it out. You know, they're making it, but they're not really, you know, they're not happy, really. They get divorced, they get, and then they wind up, then I see them at old age, and then I'm like, how about now? But I go, no, I'm still going to win. And they make a big point of watching you in your life that you know, it isn't like theirs. And, you're a tragedy. Oh, look, they're laughing at you. You're so stupid. Oh, blah, 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 blah. And then you go, well, I'm still here. And I'm doing a lot better than you. And I mean, whatever that means, I mean, in your terms, not mine. I don't think anyone really does well here. We're not here to do well. We're here to serve the Lord, and we've just got to go on that journey. That's all. And if we do well in the interim, it's that we're good stewards. You know, the Lord teaches us to be good stewards of what He entrusts us with. But I'm fully aware that if you're not a good steward for the Lord, He trusts you with stuff. He just takes it away. He'll just smack it down. If you sell it with the devil, you get a limited amount of stuff, and then when it runs out, you're done. So why wouldn't everyone accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, is my point. That's the only way to make it work out, a life work out. Otherwise, you're sitting there wondering when you're going to get your next gig. That becomes your God. When you're going to get more money coming in, that'll be your God. You know, and I know people, they just get fed up and they go, that's it. And they go run over to the devil's side because they're tired of, there was somebody that was someone Trish knows. I think I can mention this. They said to Trish something to the effect of, well, I can't follow your life anymore. This is a Facebook friend, somebody, I can't follow your life anymore because, you know, I used to have a house in an RV bigger than yours. But since I started following Jesus, that was taken away, so I can't follow your life anymore. Something to that effect. I'm pretty sure that was it. Now, what's wrong with that statement? Well, a million things. Number one, if you have a Nicodemus and a Jesus, or you have different people in different economic strata, what's that got to do with anything? Well, the thing is this person felt so angry about following Jesus, which I doubt she's doing. You know, from that letter, I would say, or that statement on a post on Facebook, I would say, I'll just assess it for you. No, this person has no relation with the Lord, because the Lord will never allow that breaking of those commandments, you know, hatred, jealousy, envy, those sort of things, or economic stuff, which is nothing because we're all going to die anyway. The Lord distributes stuff. He gives, you remember what He did with Job? He restored him to be a wealthy man from in the depths of poverty. You know, who He lifts up and who He brings, you know, who knows? As Peter said, you know, as he said to Peter, you know, what difference of it what I do to John, or if John doesn't die, you know, your fate is your fate. John's fate is his fate. What's that? What's one got to do with the other? Nothing. So if you really truly serve the Lord, I mean, I know I've abased and I've abounded too. I've been low and I've been high. And I can tell you this, in either position, it's the only thing is the Lord. I mean, it's whatever it is. It's you're still, the other things still work. You're going to have sickness. You're going to have death, tragedy. All those things, and the spiritual battle, and always trying to do for the Lord. You know, when you follow Jesus, really, you realize, you know, I would look at it another way. I'd say, well, why did, if you feel the Lord took those things away from you? So serving the Lord means poverty. And if anyone's not in poverty, they're not serving the Lord. That's not true. That's just biblically untrue. That's just a complete violation of the Word of God and a total lie. If you look back in history throughout the whole thing, a total lie. But Trish would, I guess, post pictures of, you know, RV treks. And I do go on walkabouts with I take the studio with me, a portable studio that I have. I take it with me to for because I feel that the walkabout helps me to understand things. I'm trying to understand. When it's not necessary, there won't be another drive around. If it is necessary, there will be. If it isn't, there won't be. I don't care. I could care less. You can take the RV and throw it in the trash can. I don't care. Or give it to me, fine. But if I'm upset about it, then of course, then there's a problem. But I just found that very curious. He says, I don't know what to say to this person. And I said, well, you know, it's jealousy, envy. But really what it is anger toward God. I'm serving you and look what you took away from me. And I'm like, yeah, the Lord took away those things because that person coveted those things. When you covet material things, the Lord's not going to share the stage with anybody. So if you covet wealth or covet your RV or covet your house or whatever it is, and I get, mine's bigger than yours. It's like, I don't care how big your house is, first of all, or how my house is not a big house. It's a three-bedroom, two-bath house. It's not a big house at all, and, you know, and we're pretty much stuffed to the gills here. There's not much room going on, but this is where the Lord put me, and I'm just fine with it. I don't care. But it's not big. It's three-bedroom, two-bath. I'd say that's about normal. But that's not the point. What if it was, you know, eight bedrooms and seven baths. So what? If that's what the Lord wanted me to have, I'd go get it. But I'm just not inspired to do that. I've as I'm getting older, I've come to appreciate the smallness better. You know, and as I saw what happened to my neighbor there. But it really doesn't matter. But people do judge on the size of your house. Mine was bigger than yours. Oh, really? Boy, that's really important. I mean, you know, it's like, well, I'm fine with what I have. I appreciate it. Thank you. You know, I have no idea what you're talking about. But if you do know what I'm talking about, if you do know what that conversation is, the Lord will take your house away. If you have to go proclaim it's bigger than someone else's or smaller or, you know, or if I lost everything because of Jesus. No, if the Lord took away things, it's because you coveted them or you were jealous of other people had more or bigger or whatever it was. But this person is so jealous that Trish has travels around in a normal RV, a small one actually for what it is, and sees places and does things and has a roof over her head. Then I would say that person has a real problem. I mean, she's damn mad. So if I had people do this before, when I moved in here, there was like a whole, you had this lamb cafe thing, if people remember. And there was a whole mutiny, and it all started because this woman that led the mutiny was trying to overthrow me. It was like Donald Trump or something, you know, and overthrow me. It was all because she was so mad about this house that I live in, which if I were going to improve it, I would have higher ceilings and but I just don't think I'm going to have, I just don't know what I'll do. But I mean, it didn't seem like any big deal to me, but apparently that really, and then she led this revolt against how evil I was. And then they made up all this story that I'm a sorcerer and that, you know, people are having accidents and things because of me. And it's like, well, maybe it might be because the Lord is throwing stuff at you. But anyway, I watched this whole thing, and I think they thought that I would throw the towel in, and I just kept on and going. I just like, okay, I learned my lesson. I don't let people in anymore. I don't have lamb cafes anymore. Okay, you know, fine. You know, I don't need the grief, but I will continue on with the mission the Lord's given me to continue on with. You know, I will learn from all this stuff, but I see these Christians so jealous and envious, and they all think, well, you can't, if you have anything more than me, you're not really following the Lord. And I have to say, the people with that attitude are going to be smashed economically and smashed to the ground until they are broken in a million pieces until they stop that. And conversely, if you feel that you really covet things and you really want to have something really show off that, boy, I got it now, that kind of attitude, which is basically a worldly attitude. But if you have that and you're following the Lord, if you really are truly His, He will obviously take that away from you. But never, ever make a statement like following Jesus means that you don't have anything. So if you see someone that has something, oh, they're not really following Jesus. That's what they try to do to me. Don't ever do that. Because that just shows you to be petty and jealous, envious, and in need of breaking, but good. And, you know, look, He's no respecter of persons. If I pull anything or if there's something wrong with me, you break that. And there obviously is, because I'm, you know, obviously I'm... Yesterday's pod was pretty raw, but I've let you see my frustration, I suppose, with having figured it all out. And I just see the whole thing as a spiritual battle now, not, you know, the whole thing, all the governments of the world involved in a war against God. And what do? They're agents of vengeance. It isn't, I realized yesterday, Lord, it's not about killing. It's about torture. And making people feel bad. Yes. That's what they're harvesting. Yes, absolutely. And the reason there's so many billions of people on the earth is they get more people to torture, hence more power for them. Exactly, son. That is exactly what it is. So we figured something out that I'd never heard anyone else explain. You did. But you couldn't tell me that. See, I never understood this idea of depopulation, then why not just go ahead and do it? The idea is just to, if you depopulate, then the people running it, who are actually agents of the real runners of it, right, they're possessed by them, they would lose that harvest. Yes, they would. They would lose their power, Lord. Yes, they would. They would lose their power. So that's why there's so many people on the earth. They complain they want to depopulate. But if they ever did, they would be powerless compared to where they are today. Correct. So power comes from these souls, control of, thereof. That's right. Wow. That's certainly a revelation. Well, how about that, folks? That just dropped in here right on the heels of this jealousy conversation. Well, you know, this woman that said that... obviously, she just was so far out of bounds that you don't know what to say. I used to have bigger than yours. But since following Jesus, that was all taken away. I met another woman like that, same exact thing, you know. You know, having gone to the Juilliard School and you know, having all this. And she was gunning for me because she was trying to control me. She wanted me to call her on the phone. I'm like, I can't call anyone on the phone, man. You know, I can't do that. I can't physically do it. It just kills me. It doesn't kill me. It drains me, if you will. If the Lord makes me talk to someone on the phone, I will do it or interact. But I usually can't, and I'm late getting back with email. I've worked really hard with what I do, and there's not much left over. Sorry. But, and then she was, you know, obviously really angry with me. And I didn't realize it. I mean, I had her as a friend on Google+, and I'd every once in a while comment on her. She'd comment on a video and scream and yell at how stupid these morons were, and I kind of laughed at that. But then she turned the guns on me. And it was just really interesting. And I remember that our friend Roger, he put up a Brother Thomas essay, or what he writes a word, and then Roger would put it on a screen sharing on YouTube and then go through it or whatever. And I said, hey, bro T, you know, like I, exclamation point, because I saw him out there. And, you know, I had everyone praying for him, you know, recently for his migraines. I don't have a follow-up on that, but I mean, you know, I hope things are better. I don't pray for nothing, so probably they are. Let's just hope for a breakthrough. Stop using the cell phone. Anyway, Well, I use mine. I hold it away from my head. You know? But I, you know, it's probably hurting my hand. I should probably just not ever use it. Well, I'm not on the phone right now. I'm using a recorder, an app. But think about it is, she was remembering, she wanted me to call her 3 years ago, and I didn't, but I was friends later, so I thought she kind of got over it. But she goes, "You won't call him either, and you're some bought thing out of Hollywood. You're bought and paid for, sold out to Hollywood, and your stupid music, you still believe in it. I mean, you could have made a difference for Jesus, but you really blew it, you idiot." You know, it was like on that level. And then I realized, oh my God. You know, she can't get anywhere with her music, you know, and because it sort of sucks, and even though she went to Juilliard. And she can't get anywhere with anything. And she just went into a demonic mode, yelling and screaming, trying to shame me. It's like it didn't shame me. I just felt very embarrassed for this woman who manifested because of the fact that it turns out she was mad that I was doing the music. Mad that I just kind of like was a free spirit, you know, just kind of doing what I wanted to do. I never sought to ask permission to anybody. But she was offended by doing the music and by, you know, either call or don't call. And, you know, by, I guess it was the freedom that I had had, you know, over the years. And she just blew her top. She couldn't stand that because she's, you know, in society. She was, like, involved with horses and whatever, you know, just kind of high society stuff. And I'm like, I don't follow those. I don't have those rules. I'm not in any society. So I don't, you know, I got my own loneliness issues from not being in those things. But at the same time, I'm pretty happy that I'm not, you know, kowtowing to some bunch of, you know, distractions that yield nothing. And, oh, you could have made a difference. And you might have escaped the cube. She was saying the cube, like the Saturn cube. You might have even escaped. But no, you were bought and paid for. I'm like, bought and paid for by who? But see, it was the fact that I was able to do what I was doing. The fact that she was, you know, obviously very jealous of whatever I had or what she perceived that I had. And so she was throwing her jealousy on me. And that's all it was. You know, that's the bottom line to the whole thing. Jealousy and, you know, a woman's scorn because you don't repeat your phone call, whatever. It's all bad. But it's got nothing to do with me. So I wasn't offended. I got rid of her, you know, but I wasn't really offended. I took it in stride until I saw this thing with Trish, and I really understood. There's a lot of these, and you know, she was getting older, right? She's past the, you know, whatever point of prime or whatever, you know, she was, and, you know, I saw she had a YouTube trying to play her little harp, and, you know, it was okay, but it wasn't anything virtuoso. It wasn't anything, you know, that you would say, wow, that's really something. It's just no one, you know, three views. And so there was this whole thing of, so she had to put the music down, saying stupid music. All of it is stupid, by the way. Everything, I've been involved in so many different productions, so much different kinds of music. It's been wonderful in that way. So much diversity of music, but it's all stupid. And what else? It was all stupid. And then, oh, don't, you know, I might have made a difference, but see, my credibility is blown because I'm not just groveling on the street somewhere. So therefore, I'm bought and paid for. I mean, it was all that kind of jealousy and stuff and Jezebel stuff. And therefore, no, I'm not listenable to. So therefore, she's mad that I have a listenership and that she can't make a difference. Anyway, she had her say, and you know, this bought and paid for, you know, just because I made a response on a video that I saw. And, you know, little did she know that, of course, I have been in touch with Brother Thomas by telephone from time to time, and we message back and forth. That's how I deal with most people I know. We do instant messaging, and we've been in touch recently. But, I mean, we've been in touch over the years. And so she goes, "You won't call him either." It's like, well, yes, I did call him. You know, that was an appointed, you know, a divinely appointed call. So hers wasn't, his was. So there's anger about that. So it was just like all piled up. And instead of serving the Lord, in other words, it was attack me, who she knows my feelings about the Lord. And she knows what I'm here to do. But at once she took out the shears, tried to deball me by saying, everything I've ever said is meaningless. I could have escaped the cube, but I won't now because I belong to the devil. And all the music is lousy and bad. So everything that I've done and everything I've said and everything and every single thing about my life is evil and bad and a lie from day one. And I've just wasted my time working at whatever I've worked at. It's all been one big waste of time. And then I did it because I just want to fool people. That's all. I just did all this because I just really enjoy fooling people. About what? I don't know. Since we talk about these issues, you can't really hide from what we talk about, right? So no one's trying to fool anyone, not from the dialogue we've had. There's no fooling going on because I'm not in a cult. I don't control people. I'm not trying to escape any cube. My goal is to go with the Lord. That's it. You know, I don't need to escape a cube and escape Saturn and escape this whole cockamamie kind of, you know, theory she has about what people's beliefs are. Saturn is just basically people that worship Saturn have a belief in that. That's their religion. That's got nothing to do with necessarily with reality. That's like believing in Zeus. You know, it's meaningless. But anyway, hey, there's no accounting for it. But it was everything. Every single thing that could be said. You know, your talk on the internet's been a complete waste of time. Your music is totally stupid. You're completely a waste. Nothing you say could ever, ever mean anything, since everything you say is tainted by Hollywood. And I'm saying, well, why don't you get it right? It's more like Beverly Hills, not Hollywood. And we've had that over the years, that kind of thing, by the way. That's nothing new. But again, it's all born out of jealousy. In this case, jealous of freedom. You know, of just, I think the real anger is that I, you know, that I'm not going to play the game of being a real. And then I would love to say to her or ask her this question, well, then who is doing it right that you really feel is going to escape the cube and really help us all? And the answer is she didn't have an answer to that. Because there isn't anyone. No one could reach the standard that she's talking about unless it was Jesus himself. And I would be the first to agree with her. But I'm just saying that the petty jealousy, anger, woman scorn, all this stuff has no place in Jesus' realm. And, you know, she has no right, obviously, to judge me, to condemn me in the way that I was condemned. It just makes her look like a fool. But she has no right to, none of us have any right to like condemn the other guy to the point of saying no redemption. I mean, you can't, you know, go all that far. You might have escaped the cube, which I suppose she's trying to, in her own feeble way, trying to talk about salvation. You know, escape the cube would be salvation in Jesus. Well, there's a lot of people escaping the cube, if you want to put it that way, which I don't. And, you know, and getting their salvation. But again, the Lord, you know, obviously she was angry and obviously, you know, perturbed. And suddenly after being my friend, I mean, out of the blue, I get that. And I had no idea. I mean, she was just a hothead ready to go. But she'd harbored all this anger toward me, obviously, for a long time, as did some other gal manifest. A lot of these women, they manifest as they get older, and they scream at you when you don't do what they want. And it all was precipitated from my not wanting to she wanted me to call her 3 years ago, which I don't even remember, by the way. I mean, I'm kind of, not really, not totally remember. That's what she says. So, in other words, because I didn't call her, everything I've done, everything I will say, and you know, any other form of castration, she would be willing to implement just because of not calling. Which, of course, you know, brings into question, do you really love the Lord? Do you really love, you know, your neighbor? Do you really, harbor such a hostility toward, you know, I mean, is it really, the, I mean, all the things that she said would show me that, no, she doesn't love the Lord at all. And has no clue what the Lord is. And I'm not saying that she won't in the future. Of course, I hope she does. And maybe the Lord's using this to break her. But that was a very unpleasant and uncalled for thing out of the blue. Again, it's this freedom that makes people jealous. And the Lord will do that to test us. So he'll bring somebody that you think, if someone told me a long time ago about a, you know, this is when I, you know, when I was, when I'd file my taxes, we'd be below the poverty line at one point. And, you know, and then she's going on and on. But I, you know, I had a book and you know, this is the very early beginnings. And then, you know, but very little income. I mean, it was just really, a, you know, we had some money from before, but it was, you know, kind of going. And then we were in that, so I wouldn't say high at all, but low, you know, fairly low. You know, wondering what the future would be and wondering whether this thing online we were doing was the right thing to do, you know, all those kind of thoughts. And this gal comes along and she's like, you know, in this, you know, tried to be friends and everything. And she's saying about, oh, this anointed preacher guy came by in an RV. They were traveling all over the country preaching the word of God and Jesus. And we got to be friends. And, you know, he's just so awesome and anointed. It was a way to try to see if I would be jealous of that. Now, I didn't have any RV back then. I was into that back in the 70s before anyone else was. And I even pulled had a small Fleetwood motorhome with it, and I pulled a Blazer around the country. So it's something I like to do, you know, but I got back into it, you know, a few years ago and started with a tent trailer and, you know, went up to a trailer and then eventually, you know, it's then to a used motorhome. And then I liked that, so I got a new one. It just was a progression over time. But was hitting me with all this stuff. And I admit that I think I felt a twinge of jealousy. She was trying to make me jealous, you see. But in thinking about that, I still remember that. This was going back to 2004, 2003, 2002, you know, way back there. And I really realized, you know, it sounded so romantic driving around and preaching the word, you know. And then it passed, you know what I mean? I couldn't relate to it. I didn't want to do likewise. Because I was online, so I was everywhere. So, it passed. But, I mean, the Lord will test us with things like that. Things that would, you know, it might be somebody who's suddenly got a score for a film and doing music or whatever, and it's somebody that I may have mentored, and then now they're doing film scores, and I'm still sitting here. Or it's like, you know, but wait a second, I'm not still sitting. I made a decision. I mean, if that were to happen, it wouldn't bother me now, but it might have a few years ago, but he had to beat that out of me. And I think you've witnessed it beaten out of me, this whole idea of, you know, we have our fans out there, our music people, but we reach them ourselves. We don't have the industry behind us and never will. But that had to do some accepting. Now, that doesn't mean if somebody gets a gig on a movie that they're somehow sold out, it may not. Because the Lord will lift up the foolish things and confound the wise. He'll put us in positions there. It could happen with me to score something. I'm not looking for it. You know, if it happens around me, that's fine. If someone has a bigger whatever, it's fine. Whatever. But, again, that takes some doing. And I think that it's just like the thing with any kind of relative freedom or whatever you have, or whatever you don't have. It seems to me there's always a reason why we're being broken. And in my case, the breaking today is just having a sensitivity about the world and like this sort of torturous thing that goes on in my mind about, you know, the people's motives and why it's so evil and questioning God. And see, that's where the battle is with me now. For I need to be broken of that so that I can, you know, return to my pure heart and have the Lord. Just trust so completely that I never have to go, Lord, why this? So I say that's where it is with me. And I see other people that are there, you know, and I might get jealous of them. Just like some people might get jealous of me. Well, the Lord can use jealousy. It'll be ameliorated, but he can use it as a motivator. Like, I'm jealous of people in Jesus. They seem to be able to go anywhere and do anything. They just have a freedom about them, and I want that too. Well, that jealousy could motivate me to have that too, you see. So the Lord can use that to a certain extent. But don't you find it interesting, these people, that they try to get your confidence, and then when it's funny, you know, that when you post things online, like if I post a picture, I don't really do pictures. I'm not really a picture person, but Trish is, and she posts pictures to share. It's not for any other reason, just to share, you know, this, the dog and the, you know, the beautiful storm or whatever's going on, you know, and she likes to post pictures. And, you know, but apparently that got the ire of somebody that feels that in Jesus, he took away a much bigger RV, a much bigger home. You know, but that was her sacrifice, damn it. That's what I had to pay for Jesus. I can't follow you anymore because you got those things. And when I followed Jesus, then it was taken away. I would just throw into the pot, this is what Jesus is doing with this person. Jesus is breaking this person from that need to show off with material things, which she still has, even though she doesn't have anything. Right? She's still jealous of those things. She might have been the kind of person that when she had the big RV and the big home, she'd see someone with a bigger one, right? Right? It would have that kind of thing going. All those kind of things, whether you have a trailer or you have a home or a mobile home or a motor home or whatever kind of home you have or no home or a tent or whatever it is, you know, all glory to God, you know. Each of us is being tested, tried a million different ways through all kinds of economic strata and, you know, social strata and, you know, different circumstances. You know, like my other thing now is I'm looking at people that are old and they're dying, they're losing their minds. And also losing the money they thought they had, you know, and their families are having to step in. I'm seeing this, and I really feel like I need to, and, you know, I need to soften my heart for when they were younger. Look out for them a little better, you know. These criminals that were there stealing everything from her, there's nothing I could do about that. People have free will. I can't just intervene and say I'm taking over. It's not my place. But I watched all this happen, and I remember back to the time where the demon jumped out at me from her and said, "So do you need Jesus to save you?" Like in that kind of voice, kind of like a Jonathan Cleck story, and leapt out at me. I was kind of surprised, but then I said, "Yes, I do." You know, I answered that, but there was this kind of like, you know, I don't know. There's this looking down on me because of the fact that we were, you know, not playing the little game that she liked to. All that kind of stuff happened, you know what I mean, over the years. And I kind of backed away because I didn't want to be attacked every day, you know what I mean? I didn't want to be, you know, insulted. And I get enough of that from Christians who think they know everything. The ones that are the most egregious, I think the ones you have to watch out for the most, are always those people that they have some kind of understanding in the Bible, they think. See, it's written right there, so that proves it. And they start trying to prove their point by quoting Bible verse to make a point And so they find verses that suit their opinion. And then they state it's like it's gospel truth because, see, I got a scripture that lines up with it. When that's not no proof at all. And this is just a ridiculous way to live. And it's just used to play a game of gotcha. And there's a lot of people in that category. I mean, I knew them when I was here. I don't have the energy, you know, the time really to joust with these people these days, because it's really just a tremendous waste of time. And also it's an insult to our Lord. It's a complete insult to intellectualize him and to think, you know, you've put God in a box and, you know, God can't lie. He says it in his word. You see, it's right there. So then you become God yourself, you know, telling God what he can and can't do. You know, it's terrible. It's just terrible. But one thing we need to do, and we really need to do this, we really need to be a little, if we can be more loving. That doesn't mean when someone says jump, you jump. When people say jump to me, I don't jump. And then they get mad, and then they want to crap all over everything and tell me everything is bad from the very beginning of my life. I should never have been born. I should just go out and kill, like this woman was like, you know, in other words, everything you've done is wrong and faulted, and it's just a total sellout. Well, how about this? I wish I had just told her, well, should I just put a bullet to my head now, or do you want me to wait till next month? You know, would it please you if I went ahead and just killed myself? Because there's really no point to live since I've blown it all. Oh, no, she probably would have said, yeah, pull the trigger. There's no need for you to be alive. Of course, and then people that have that attitude are not Christian. They are. They don't have the Holy Spirit. They don't have an anointing. That's probably why her harp playing didn't go anywhere, because she doesn't have that anointing. You know, you've got to have God's hand on you to do music and stuff. Even if you're doing it for the dark side, those gifts are given without repentance. She wasn't gifted. She could be academically gifted and follow the rules and, you know, play, you know, by the numbers. But in terms of gifted, like you know, the artists that are distinguished in those fields, there's something special there. And that touch was not given to her. So she's mad. And then me, I'm just a fool doing stupid music. But see, the fact that I believe in that stupid music was the thing that made her so angry, that even though it's stupid, I can't see it's stupid, because she's actually been to Juilliard. So, you know, if she says it's stupid, it's really stupid. But that I believe in it. No, not only that, I would say I do much more than believe in it. I get pleasure from it. I enjoy it. It's just part of it's just the art that I, you know, that I do. It's just like a life's work. It's definitely a respite from the storm. It's just definitely something that also informs people and it touches people that you wouldn't think, you know, and if that leads to their salvation or whatever. And it gives people something to think about and something to sing, you know. I do music for its own sake. I don't try to make it have a message each time. That's not me. We've done that a little bit with DCP, and, you know, about social issues. But I'm not really, you know, it's just all really, I don't even know where, you know, it just goes where it goes. I just have to trust that, you know, it's going to be, but if someone says it's stupid or it's intelligent, I mean, compared to what, you know, I don't know. Compared to Jay-Z, compared to, you know, compared to who, Jethro Tull? I mean, compared to what? pop singers? I mean, compared to what? Compared to, was it Barry Manilow? Compared to what? You know? Itzhak Perlman? I mean, compared to what? So they can't answer that. And, you know, they just want you to know that it's stupid. Like, you shouldn't be doing it. I had another one curse me on that, too. That they said, you know, Zeph, I just want to tell you this, you know, because I know you do very serious. You work really hard at this music. This is back 2005 or 6 when I was really doing a lot of kind of instrumental pieces. And they were saying, you know, I just want to tell you this because I'm your friend, you know. You know, none of this is ever going to go anywhere. Just so you know that. Oh, gee, thank you. for coming out of the woodwork and telling me that. And basically putting a curse on the whole thing. And you know, it's funny. It was right after that that the thing hit the wall. I couldn't make any more because I was making pretty good money on some of the tracks. They were being used in disco. I already had been a success for me beyond my wildest dreams. I had, you know, various discos or other DJs playing me. I was used in a lot of number of different podcasts and all kinds of things back in those days. And had sold quite a few MP3s, you know, as these different tracks came out. Right after that was said, that all stopped. Whether it was by design or not, you know, but I think I'm supposed to recognize that. So they threw some kind of, it's okay, you know, it took me into, I started singing after that. And then, of course, you know, there were no sales at that. No, because that imposes a whole thing that people don't want to deal with. You know, when it's instrumental and it's loop-based and sample-based, so it sounds pretty damn good. You know what I mean? It's like, that's fine. Then I put interesting patterns together and different arrangements. And they really, you know, they really liked it. But as soon as I start getting into, like, lyrics and vocals and things, you know, so kind of, it's not fair to say it was cursed, and therefore there was a powerful rich that put a curse. No. It took a turn there. Plus, the MP3 world, people were no longer that. I had the tail end of it, and then after that, people were no longer selling the MP3s because streaming started coming in and different things, and you know, it just wasn't that indie world dried up for everybody, not just me. But I just remember there was someone else that cursed it, that just said, you know, or in their own mind, I want to take you aside. I know you're working really hard at this, and you know, you really like the music, and you know, you really like what you're doing, which is even more bizarre because, you know, you can't see how embarrassing it is that, you know, you're just not that good, you know, and you're enjoying it. And I just want to tell you, you know, just as one friend to another, nothing's ever going to happen with this music. Just want you to know that. And it's funny, since that was said, nothing really has happened with it other than my own effort and people that listen to the Zeph Report enjoying it or whatever, but that's quite a few people, actually. That's more than even that's beyond my expectations. But in terms of, you know, the world, your stupid music, no. So I've had numerous, mainly women, cursing it and that telling me that it's, you know, you know, don't worry, it's not, nothing's gonna, you know, happen with your music. It's just, and they keep doing this. It's like Satan keeps sending these women to make sure it stays down. Well, that makes me think that it won't always be obscure. But whether it's obscure or not, if I don't continue with a good hearted about it. In other words, the test for me is, okay, despite all that and everybody saying it's crap and I'm delusional for believing in it, I continue on. You know, and to them I would say, well, you know, hey, this was then, here's where I'm at now. But you know what? I bring my best. And if it's not good enough for you, well, that's fine. It's not up to standard. If that's your opinion, fine. But guess what? I have tremendous freedom in music, and I don't just do music, I do sound. So it's a whole different thing. Sound, music, mastering, mixing, I bring all that to it. So I really enjoy it. You know, I mean, it's a real struggle too. You know, it's really a challenge. Every song is, every piece is, it's got a different set of things you have to overcome, and takes really tight focus and dedication because you have to keep coming after it. I worked really hard at it. At times, not every day, but I mean, there are times I'm really into something, I work really, really hard at it to just get it right. And then if somebody wants to say it's don't worry, it's nothing to see here, folks. Nice try, Zeph. That's fine, but you know, that's not, wherever that's coming from, that reminds me of the playground in grade school, like in third grade. Don't worry, Zeph, you're not going to get favor with the pretty girl over here or with the guys over here or with somebody over there. It's like, okay. or Zeph, you know, does anyone understand you? And my response is, I don't care if they understand me or not. I'm gonna do it. I don't care. I can't help it. I am who I am. If it's ununderstandable, that's fine. I'll just keep producing it anyway. And that's the thing that makes them so mad. They don't care. I know how good the music is. I know that it's you know, some of it is top-notch, and I know some of it is just, it's my own proclivity. It's my own idiosyncratic thing. You know, I know some of it's like that. And some, it's all interesting, though. It's all highly produced, meaning it's all, you know, produced professionally. So, hey, that is beyond any expectation I ever had for it to be produced professionally. I never thought I would ever get to that point. So to me, it's all, the whole journey has been win, win, win. It's been totally therapeutic. It's been totally joy producing. It's been a lot of fun collaborating with people. This is what they hate. This is what they hate. So when we have Christians hating that's freedom. So they have such joy. You have joy. And I'm seeing Kelly's writing something that's going to be in a piece I'm producing. It's a longer piece with several pieces of music in it. And I can see she's having a lot of fun doing that. And it's like, the hell, go, girl. Yeah, enjoy it. Let's do stuff. You know, let's make this thing happen. You know, we're musicians. Let's do things. And then I could sense a real happiness in her when she was like on the trail of her part of the story, and she was putting a little acoustic thing to it. It had to do with a guy that's, I'll just say this briefly. It's a guy who just really doesn't accept that he's dead. And where it goes, I don't know. You'll have to tune in. It won't just be one shot at this. I mean, there'll be more probably, but it's not like I can whip this song out in a day. It has different parts, and it's a sonic interlude is what it is. You know, it's a sonic kind of a journey, and it's got various kind of music in it. And I'm hoping to add a rock piece to it to finish it, and it just all depends, because I've been blocked lately. But a block usually just means it's still processing. But when people bring their stuff, it's usually what they're reacting to and what the world reacts to and what the world can't stand. And this is what I think when we go into Donald Trump. They sense a freedom with him, and they just can't stand it. He just isn't following their rules. And their rules are arbitrary. Their rules aren't really rules at all. They're the silent rules that he's breaking that they can't stand. In other words, you speak your mind. Oh, they hate that. He did a press conference yesterday that was almost blacked out there because they're trying to build up, you know, the darling, you know, Carly Fiorina, Jeb Bush and all that. They're trying to build them up and meanwhile diminish him. So their Fox doesn't carry the very newsworthy press conference he had in speech. I don't know whether he's in Iowa or somewhere. And even like people like Major Garrett was there and other, you know, top journalists. He was fabulous. He was amazing. And he just knows exactly what he wants to do with the country. And he just laid out, he said, well, there's no policy here. It's like, I would refer people to his book where he wrote out all the policy. He has tons of policy. You know, it's fiscal conservatism. It's bringing manufacturing. The biggest policy that he has is bringing jobs back here from Mexico and China, and bringing factory jobs back here, bringing, you know, a strong working class and, you know, strong growth to the United States in a part of research. That's like number one right there. Fixing immigration, having Mexico pay for the wall. The reason Mexico will pay for the wall, he outlined, is because Mexico is making a ton of money off the United States right now because we're bad negotiators. But Mexico will make money anyway. The wall is a pittance compared to how much money they're making off of us. So therefore, you know, they'll pay for the wall because it's going to be good for both. And the immigration will be, you know, regulated. It'll be just like a streamlined process and make it fair and doable and fix it. Because Obama's solution is total chaos. which goes to his being a revolutionary, that basically he wants to kill the whole world. That's all it really is. That's all. The hardcore commie revolutionary isn't interested in putting people in slavery and then basically committing genocide. And that's all they're about. They don't build anything. They just take over a regime and sit there, lavishing themselves with millions and millions of dollars while everybody else is in a little cage with, you know, electrons on their head, microphones on their head, you know, hearing their thoughts, make sure they think the right thought, you know, total tyranny, totalitarianism, 1984. I mean, that's all they don't have any. The reason they regulate is so they can regulate further. It's to keep limiting, punishing, stopping, controlling, no growth, no economy, bankrupt, throw it over George Soros' mentor, you know, have riots, have destabilization, bring immigrants in, bring criminals in, which is the most important part of the Obama policy. Is numero uno with these people is to let the criminals bring specifically recruit criminals to come in, because they know that they can the criminals will then control the ghettos and they will control the criminals. So they have a whole strategy there that they don't tell people. I had it in my book Lamb. They let the criminals out on the street because the criminals are very organized and they can run the streets. And so then the government runs them, and that's how they get control. Making sure to keep people, well, what's the point of Obama and the black people? Is Obama black? He's half black. Okay. What's his goal with black people? To keep them in the ghetto and with no upward mobility whatsoever and to foment riots. That's the upshot of his administration. Whereas Donald Trump wants to get all boats rising. It doesn't matter what race you are, because he's not a racist. And that's the other thing I like about him. He doesn't have that. He's not being a hypocrite either. And people sense that. Latinos sense that and they like him. Black people sense that and they like him. I can tell. They understand he's where he's coming from. And it's really something. And the reason all these Republican hypocrites and all these people are after him is because it's not because of anything he said. It's just because of how he is. And he's in the political arena, and he doesn't seem to he's going to the beat of a different drummer. He doesn't seem to hear all the same things that apply to these people don't apply to him. So then Rand Paul has really completely destroyed his reputation and his campaign by focusing everything on Donald Trump, which is completely ridiculous, you know. And I told him on Twitter, at least, I said, you know, please focus on your own policies and leave him out of it. But he won't do it. He's obsessed. And I think it goes back to on the stage that night during the debates where he said, you know, that Rand Paul was kind of stumbling on something, and Donald Trump goes, oh, you're really having trouble tonight. I think that little quip got to his pride and got him, you know, on the warpath. But it wasn't an innocent thing on Donald Trump's part. But he got the ire of Rand Paul. Now Rand Paul's willing to flush his entire campaign down the tubes just to get the Donald out. Everyone's tried to get this Donald out, including trying to ignore him out and push the other candidates up. And nobody's really going to care about, you know, Marco Rubio or especially not Jeb Bush. Chris Christie, even a Scott Walker, he may be okay, but he's just not that. They're just apples and oranges. Again, the Lord brought this very unlikely person in, who they all were laughing at and mocking at first. They're not laughing now; they're crying. They're pissed off. They're upset. They're off their game, and the guy, while everyone else is talking heads and complaining about him, he's out campaigning in the doldrums of August when everything's supposed to be dead. He's out campaigning and taking press conferences and doing all kinds of things for his. So he's undaunted, totally. And I just watch this and go, how can any man, this completely defies logic. And I got to say that I don't know how long it's going to last, but I'm enjoying it. Because I see that it's defined, Lord, and his policies that he wants to do, manufacturing, more employment, good jobs, They're not like Romney, but I mean, really implement stuff, really negotiate to get stuff going good for the United States. I mean, it's against the policy before is to downgrade the United States on purpose, lose every negotiation we're involved in, send all our jobs overseas, and then put a fence around the United States, and then bring in the military to punish the people with the police state and martial law, take their guns away, confiscate everything, and punish them for having been born here in the first place and taken all the resources from all the other people, and then equalize all the other people after the punishment phase. Now, that's your hardcore revolutionary that wants to do that. That is just anti-human. But that's, in my view, what they really want to do. I mean, I don't think Obama could care less. What he wants to do is get most of the people unemployed, cloud pivot it, you know, overwhelm the system, and then go out of office saying, hey, he had employment down to 5%. Nobody else did. When they're lying and say they don't acknowledge that, you know, 100 million people are out of the workforce, the most in history. Therefore, qualify the U.S. as a Great Depression. And causing Michael Savage, who's really smart on especially predicting things, who's come to say that I don't know if we can last 2 years. He really doesn't know, in his opinion, whether we'll last 2 years or not. And I don't either. And that's why I'm speaking up and trying to, and addressing some of this stuff, because I, you know, it'd be a shame to let one man ruin the United States forever and ever, wouldn't it? And destroy all of you and maybe kill you all. Wouldn't that be terrible that he got away with that? Well, you won't be here to say whether it's the Antichrist or not anyway, so it's a moot point. You got conquered, you got killed. At least Donald Trump is some kind of form of fighting back against the hypocritical and awful nature of... You've seen the establishment of Republicans. We voted in Congress and Senate, and what have they done? Passed every policy Obama ever wanted, and then some. Including keeping abortion ongoing. In other words, there was no change. We got the gay thing. We got the, you know, this and that. We got the oath of marriage thing. Obamacare doubled down upon by this wonderful Judge Roberts. What a great, wonderful guy he is. How wonderful, how wonderful. Oh, God really broke the mold. He made such a wonderful man as Judge Roberts. I mean, can I think of anyone more beautiful and wonderful than that? We should all just be almost cowed by his great wisdom, saying yes to everything that he says. Well, what he is a globalist and a totalitarian and a sellout and, you know, an asshole. And it's people like that that are in these places all over the place that are allowing Obama to do what he does. So they're all working for him. He's got them all in his pocket. But still, it would be a shame. You know where this goes. I mean, I think this guy, Steve Forbes, put it best, where he said, you know, we have complete unemployment here. You know, the worst since, you know, the Great Depression. We have, you know, and a whole litany of things that's wrong. We have trade imbalances. We have, you know, $20 trillion worth of debt that can never be paid back. We have the world economy collapsing. What did you expect? Steve Forbes said the other day. He goes, I mean... After all that, what did you expect? We'd be doing great right now? No, they're doing smoke and mirrors so they can destroy the economy in a way that you sit there and say it's cool. See what I mean? In a way to make you think everything's fine while they destroy it, and then they're going to hand you the bag at the very end so that Obama wouldn't be blamed. To acclimate you to a new kind of downgraded lifestyle. And then don't worry, they want to take away the air conditioners and all the unnecessary things that you've got and really regulate you at the end, you know. Just like I say, the best thing for them would be you to rack them and stack them cages and put electrodes on your head so they can monitor every little thought to make sure and hook it all up to this ultra super duper computer that will flag people that have the wrong thought so they can be regulated. You know, through shock treatment. And that would be the ultimate. Oh, because why kill them off? Why not just put them in little, you know, little tubes and just torture them as long as they can keep them alive? Isn't that where the power comes from? Because if you kill him, you have no more power. Meanwhile, there's another faction. Not a faction, there's the leadership of the pyramid, of the council. And what they want is they want to call off the Albert Pike Three World Wars thing. What they want is they want to just get back to an economic model that brings prosperity to people, which is the cardinal sin for Obama. He doesn't want prosperity for anybody except his crony capitalist friends, his billionaire class friends, who he's out at Martha's Vineyard with right now. Anyway, you black folk out there, he does not... You're just a political, a useful tool for him when he wants it. But there's no loyalty there. You know, that's the thing that people are trying to tell you. There is no loyalty there. You know, it's all about corporate interests. And, you know, and the immigration proves there's no loyalty there because these immigrants are going to be, you know, they're overriding everybody, and including many Latinos who are here and more established are, you know, watching the system be overwhelmed by all this and realizing already that their lives are being jeopardized as well. So you've got, and then there's the war on whites, you know, where you white people, they just want to get rid of you so that it's either, but it's going to be all Hispanic probably in the end. And then the blacks will still be where they are, kind of relative to the scale of the Hispanics will replace the whites. And then there'll be resentment between those two groups. I get so mad that people don't wake up to what they're doing. If we should not see race. We should all come together to survive this onslaught of the enemy, which is basically the soldiers of Satan, basically, is what it really comes down to, because they want to change all the laws and everything to be 100% opposite of God's ways, and then have that implemented by law, and then get rid of anyone who thinks otherwise. Anyway, that's why I do the podcast, to elucidate these issues, and I'm going to go ahead and go now, because now you've really gotten it from me. 2 hours, 26 minutes, and 49 seconds, folks. Shalom, shalom, shalom. I love you. I'm praying for you. I hope you don't mind some of the negativity. It's you know, I'm not ultimately negative, you know. I'm going to be, you know, I'm doing what I could do. I just get frustrated when I see the overwhelm of it all. And the people not responding in a way that they should, which is not only no, but hell no. Let's, you know, so I think, you know, maybe in some weird little way, Donald Trump represents people rebelling against this seemingly implacable end of all of us, including all the minorities, which will be majorities soon. And do I care if white, black, or do I care what color is the majority in this country? No, I don't. I'm a minority in New Mexico. Does it bother me? Not one bit. Would I do business with people like, you know, that have names like Martinez and Chavez? Does that bother me? Are you kidding me? That's the norm around here. That's the norm, and that's wonderful. What's wrong with that? You know, I just don't understand that. Anyway, you have to be taught to be a racist. I don't think it's something that a kid just picks up. They have to be taught by somebody to be a racist, because I guess I missed that part of my education. I was, you know, the only, if you say, well, you're somewhat racist. Well, I mean, I may be programmed a little bit from the news or whatever to know that, watch out, if you go into a bad neighborhood, they could get you. You know, I've got that kind of racism, but that's just based on a survival instinct and not being stupid. Like, I don't go play on the freeway. You know, if I'm a white person, I'm not going to the south side of Chicago at, you know, 11 o'clock at night down some of those streets down there. I would be basically like a pinata looking for someone with a baseball bat. I don't think that's probably not a good idea. It doesn't mean I'm racist. It just means that I don't want to die like right now. If I can live a few more days, you know, great. But I value life. I value common sense. I realize that a lot of these the Ferguson thing that is whipped up, we didn't talk about that. Okay, shoot, I got to do this in 2 seconds. I love you playing for you. And now I'm going to keep talking. Ferguson, George Soros, and Obama out at Martha's Vineyard, but he's talking about it. So he's very involved in Ferguson. You know, they tried, let me just sum it up real quick and then I'm out of here. They tried to get it going last year. They wanted a summer of violence, remember? A summer of cities burning. Well, here we are in August. The summer's about over. Okay, we're coming into the second half of August, and we don't have our cities burning. So you see, it was supposed to happen, and they didn't get it. Remember how God has the minds, and he turns... Now you're being reminded, but watch how the Lord steers this. And Obama is off aloof, acting like, well, I'm out in Martha's Vineyard just enjoying myself, but I have to weigh on this. This is terrible what's happening in Ferguson. Terrible what these cops are doing. Terrible what the racism in America is all about. It's like, well, I don't hear you talking. There's nothing really going on here in New Mexico. What are you talking about? I mean, the racism we're trying to whip up through white George Soros money. Because George Soros and Obama shared one thing. They get money and power out of these race wars. And that's what they've also got their buddies in the CIA fomenting it up with them. And they just keep trying one evil thing after another. Hey, CIA, you guys should do a house cleaning and straighten up and fly right. Same with the FBI, same with the Pentagon, and everybody else in a position of power. Get the corruption out of there. We just don't want to be that kind of country. Then everybody loses. Everyone loses. Everyone loses. Everyone loses. I'm sick of us losing. You know? I mean, the CIA has no business, zero, or the FBI being involved in helping to foment, you know, delivering truckloads of Molotov cocktails for these guys to throw and whatever else. No business in that doing that dirty business of fake riots. Fake, CIA. Fake, fake, fake. You're fake. Fake, not organic, but fake riots and this whole race meme, you know, and trying to implement it to what? Divide, conquer the awful people of America who have guns, who want freedom, whatever. No. You either straighten up or, you know, all you corrupt ones are going to get exposed and you're going to get in trouble. It's a fair warning. You know, you think you're on the right side of everything now, it could turn on you later. If I were you, I would get out of the business of corruption and into the business of being a straight, you know, straight arrow, a good egg, do the right thing, and let's start cleaning this, the town, you know, it's high noon, we need to clean the town up, okay? And that's what I believe this Donald Trump thing is, that's why he's ruffling so many feathers, because these people in the news media, I see where Fox News wants to go and the rest of them, they all want this sort of new world order, you know, and they don't have your best interest at heart, America. Well, that could change in time, yes. And I just want to always say that it could change. If you people change, then it will change. But you just can't sit there like a deer in the headlights going, I guess it's going to happen. There's nothing I can do about it. And then just going off into the tragic slaughterhouse. I mean, don't do that, please. Just change your attitude, at least that much, especially if you say you're a Christian. Then we're forbidden to say exactly what's going to happen tomorrow like we know it all. I can tell you what their motives are, but also I can see right now the 11th attempt at World War III has been thwarted once again. And you don't even know what angels to thank. Your back has been looked after. And you're not even grateful. All right. With that, I bid you shalom, shalom, shalom. Love, peace, and Jesus.